we were lucky enough to snag for our first interview, Miss Avery Summers.
And it's a joy to be here. Thank you.
Well, thank you. I'm glad you consented to come over. I'm really happy that you're the first interview tonight because, well, she's Avery Summers, but also because she's a veteran in the theater world, both locally, regionally, and abroad. Avery, you're nominated tonight, yes?
Yes, I am. Yes.
And for what?
For The Devil's Music, The Life and Blues of Bessie Smith.
Yes, Bessie. Go, Bessie.
Yes.
I saw that, and that was presented at Arts Garage, yes?
Yes, that's correct.
Now, The Devil's Music is a piece of work that's been around for a while.
Yes.
Did you ever think it would land in your lap?
No, because honestly, I had never heard of it.
Really?
I had never heard of it. Never, ever heard of it.
Well, it's funny because it was produced some years ago, I think back in the 90s, by one of the local theaters, and I did get a chance to see it. So I'm really surprised that you hadn't heard of it.
I may not have been here at the time. I do know after the fact that it was produced in South Florida and that it had a run in New York also, but I had never heard of it, and I was really glad to audition for it. It was wonderful.
So it was a success, a raging success. How do you feel about it taking a look back in hind view?
You know, it hasn't really been that far back yet. I'm still very, very excited about it and wish that I could still do it. Because, of course, after the fact, you think, oh, my God, I could have done so-and-so, or I should have done this, or maybe I could have done this a little bit better, you know. And I think that we all, as performers, judge ourselves that way. But overall, I was thrilled,
yeah.
Thrilled with it.
Yeah. Yeah, great. What's on the horizon?
I've got a couple of things that I cannot talk about just yet, but one of them that I can talk about is working with Aaron Kula, who does klezmer music, which is the wonderful Jewish music. And he works on the FAU campus as the curator of the Jewish music, and he has a wonderful orchestra, and I'm going to be joining them.
Wow, that sounds really exciting.
Yes, yes.
Well, if you need an extra voice, let me know.
Okay, well, I know you have the chops, so that wouldn't be hard to do.
I would love to do something new and interesting like that.
Yes.
That's the one thing I'd like about you. You spread your tentacles throughout the community, and you're involved in a lot of different things with a lot of different people, and that's very admirable. Is that something that you seek to do, or is that something that just comes to you?
Well, originally it was not something that I sought out. I wanted to be in the real theater community of South Florida, but I'd been away for a lot of years, and when I came back, I was amongst the people that they weren't really sure what to do with me, how to cast me, you know. So I thought, well, I think I'd better figure out how to work on my own.
Mm-hmm.
And I created my cabaret, which has led me to work with other people, especially young people.
Mm-hmm.
I love that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's great.
Yes.
It's great talking to you. I know that you also teach for young people.
Yes.
So that's always a great thing, giving back to young people. Thank you for being our first interview tonight.
Okay.
I want to wish you much luck, success. Any last thing you'd like to impart?
Well, I'm just so excited to be here tonight. Really, seriously, you hear people say what a joy it is just to be nominated. And it's true. It really is. It feels wonderful.
Yeah,
so thank you very much, Karen.
Thank you very much.
You're very welcome.
I love you.
Love you too.
Thank you. Hi. So I've drawn another handsome, debonair actor into my net this evening, and that is Mr. Ajamon Clay. Hi.
Hi. How are you?
I'm great. It's great to see you.
Great to see you. Thank you for having me. I'm truly honored to be here. I'm very excited. It's my first one, so, you know, I'm looking forward to it.
This beautiful young man is nominated for his first Carbonell Award in Gable Stage's production of The Royale, in which he played boxer Jack Johnson. Yes, I saw it. It was all of that and a bag of chips, and so is he. So, I know, yeah, take it all in, take it all in, take it all in. So, seriously, though, for this to be your pretty much your first stage role, you know?
Stage debut, yeah.
Yeah. Tell us, talk about it.
It's like the whole year is just going through my brain right now. I think it was just, I think Joe at the Gable stage, giving me a shot, giving me a chance. You know, I hadn't performed yet, but, you know, I had been preparing and I had been in class and I had been in auditions and this opportunity came. And I think just him being able to give me a shot, because early on, you know, he's like, all right, if you're going to do this, I'm going to, you know, you got to do this. And I committed. I just did the work, you know, I really did. And I paid reverence to the character. And there was so much great information for research for the play. And we just from day one were like a team, very cohesive, and we all got along. We still text and talk to this day, and it was just kind of one of those atmospheres, because it was ugly at first, because there was a lot of rhythm and claps and stomps, and sometimes I have two left feet, but we just, you know, we committed. We committed every single day, and we made it happen.
Yeah. For Joe to give you a chance, that's no small hill of beans, you know. For Joe to do that, that means that he had a lot of confidence in you, because Joe doesn't just, you know, do that. I mean, he really, if he goes out on a limb, he's doing it for a reason. So you have a lot to be proud of. How much training did you have to do for that role?
Oh, my gosh. I have a whole new respect for boxers. You have to take, go back and think, like, a boxer, like, gets punched in the face for a living. Like, so I would go to certain gyms, and like Monday they'd be sparring, and then I would go like Tuesday and we're training, and like Wednesday or Thursday they're sparring again. I'm like, they're getting hit again? Like, this is just what they do all day, every day. So getting into that mentality and the discipline, you know, it really is a sweet science. And you know, everybody loves boxing, but this was just an even more a dynamic story. The first African-American boxing heavyweight champion of the world, who had a time where the strongest, most powerful people in the country were the president, were the general, and then the boxing champion. And to be, you know, in a situation where you should have been celebrated as an American hero, you were vilified, and to be able to tell that story and make it come alive was, you know, with Marco's words, the playwright, you know, it was just a phenomenal experience. And furthermore, so many things that were happening, like Muhammad Ali died during the run of this show, and you know, Jack Johnson inspired Muhammad Ali to be great. So I'm just a little small piece of the puzzle, and I was just happy I could tell the story.
Well, you did a great job.
You.
So you've tossed your hat into the ring in the Big Apple now,
yes.
Right?
Yes. Yeah. I've been in New York auditioning. You know, fortunately, you know, that's why this event is so special, and South Florida theater is so special that such good press and publicity from the show was able to get me representation in New York, and now I'm auditioning for the likes of, you know, Warner Brothers and Fox and HBO, and that means a lot, because you know, it just shows that the respect that they have for our theater community. So yeah, it's you know, I've taken it one day at a time, but I am very, very inspired by the opportunities that I'm getting.
Well, awesome. Unfortunately, I have to wind up this interview. You know, I could sit here all night, Mark, right?
Okay.
But it's okay.
Yeah.
Good luck tonight. Good luck in New York. Good night. Look tonight. And it's good to see you.
I just want to, again, say thank you to the Carbonells for having me. You know, thanks to Joe for giving me the shot. Thanks to Marco for having a great play. And my castmates, you know, it was, I am getting nominated for an individual award, but it was very, very much a group play. You know, if his line doesn't trigger his line, doesn't trigger her line, then I don't work. So it was very much an ensemble cast, and Max and Greg Wiener, Ryan George, Shane Montpremier, and Andre Ganey, and also our movement coordinator, Rudy, are just as deserving of a nomination as I am. Thank you.
You're good. You know what to say. And that's a great thing. That comes from a very humble place to mention your castmates. So good for you. All right. We'll see you inside.
All right. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm here with another handsome, debonair actor. Christian Vanderfast. Hi, Christian.
Hi, Karen. How are you doing?
I'm great. I forgot to tell the audience that whenever there's a guy sitting here, I'm going to be flirting and maybe a female or two as well. So yeah. Just be prepared.
Not too much. My fiance is back there.
Oh, it's okay. She doesn't care. Okay, it won't go further than this chair, I promise.
All right, thank you.
So you're nominated tonight. Tell us what for, what role, and what theater company.
Well, I'm nominated for A Minister's Wife for Best Supporting Actor in a Musical from Gable Stage.
Great. This isn't your first nomination.
No, it's not my first nomination. The first one was with Bonnie and Clyde. It was also for Best Supporting in a Musical for Slow Burn. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and then we also were nominated before with Alliance Theater Lab for Best Ensemble. So.
Okay, so how are you feeling about tonight?
I'm nervous.
Yeah.
I don't know why. I feel a little bit nervous. You know, but honestly, I'm just ready to have a good time and see a lot of cool people and just hang out and have a great night. So. Mm-hmm.
Is there something about this particular role that was special to you?
Oh, I mean, there was a lot of things. I mean, for one thing, it was the first role I got to work with Gable Stage, so that was very great, and got to work with a lot of great people, with Laura Hodes, Jim Ballard, Shane Tanner, a lot of great people, and it was just a really fun, very rigorous process working in that show, but it really turned out to be one of the best experiences I had in a show. So I'm really happy to be nominated for such a production.
Well, I want to give you some props because I saw that show, and everything I've seen you in, you really step up to the plate. You're a chameleon. It's hard to describe, but you take the shape and form of whatever character you play, and that is the goal of an actor.
Well, thank you. Yeah. that means a lot to me. Thank you very much.
I know. It's hard to take compliments.
but I really appreciate it.
Yeah, it's the truth, though. You're very talented. I love watching you work. So I'm going to say, I'm wishing you luck tonight.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Karen. Thank you.
Is there something else you'd like to say to the South Florida theater audience?
Guys, I'm really going to have a wonderful time tonight. I hope you will, too, and have a wonderful, wonderful theater prom.
Thank you.
See
you inside.
See you inside.
Joining me is Christina Groom. Hi, Christina.
Hi.
What are you nominated for tonight?
I'm nominated for Best Supporting Actress in a Play.
And for what show?
For Perfect Arrangement.
Perfect Arrangement. And what theater?
That was Island City Stage.
Great. You got great reviews for that play. What was it like doing that play?
It was actually a truly wonderful experience. All of the members of the cast got along wonderfully. It really was a perfect arrangement in regards to that. The entire production team, everybody, we had a blast doing the show. And for a show that, it had, broadly comic elements, and then it had very serious elements, and we had a good time doing all of it. So.
Which is the best kind of play to do.
Yes.
Something that has a little of both things. You've done a lot of theater been around in the South Florida theater area. Was this your first time doing, it wasn't your first time working for Island City Stage, was it?
No, actually, the last time I worked for Island City Stage, I was also nominated for a Carbonell for Best Supporting Actress, so I think through my lucky charm.
Hey, you'll take it, right?
Exactly.
What's coming up for you?
Actually, right now I'm going on to a bit of a hiatus as soon as I finish up with All the Way at Actors Playhouse. And then I believe next up will be Shorts Gone Wild, again with Island City Stage and City Theater.
Okay, what are you playing at in All the Way?
I am part of the ensemble, so I am Muriel Humphrey, Laureline Wallace, LBJ's secretary, a nurse, a attendee for the... all kinds of things. I mean, it's like I'm just on and off stage, like mad.
Oh, that's okay. Jack of all trades. I understand. That is my thing. That's my MO, so I do understand. So before you leave us, is there something that you'd like to tell our viewing audience about the South Florida Theater that they might not know?
Something that might not know. I don't know. I believe, hopefully, that everybody knows that it's incredibly diverse. There's something for everyone. If you want something that's a little more avant-garde, there are places to go for that. If you want your classic musical theater, your contemporary plays, everything, there's a little bit of everything. So you just go out there and look for it, and it's there.
Great. Thank you. You look beautiful tonight,
by
the way.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Who are you wearing? No, you don't have to answer that. You don't have to answer that. But you do look absolutely beautiful. Good luck tonight, and I'll see you in there later.
All right. Thank you. Okay. See you later.
I seem to be snatching quite a few handsome, debonair gentlemen actors tonight, Mark. Here's another one, Mr.
Silver tongue devil.
Yes, I am. Mr. Peter Galman.
Hello.
Welcome.
Aaron. It's good to see you.
Thank you. It's good to see you. Yeah. What are you nominated for tonight?
I'm nominated for a play that I can no longer pronounce the title of. Wait, let me get to it. It's called A Public Reading of an Unfinished Screenplay about the Death of Walt Disney.
And that was at Thinking Cap Theater?
Thinking Cap Theater, and it's a production that was done last summer, and it was originally done in San Francisco, I believe. An Orlando native wrote it. Lucas Naith wrote the play. He knew a thing or two about Walt Disney.
And you played the role of Walt Disney?
I played Walt. It's done as a screenplay, too, so there's a lot of tricky dialogue in it, because I'm sort of reading as I would be reading a screenplay, cut to, close up on, so forth. Mm-hmm. And so I'm doing all the stage directions, and then I'm sort of directing traffic on stage too, and then occasionally we immerse ourselves in the characters and play out a scene. It's wild. Mm-hmm.
It was a wonderful production, I saw it, and you were quite wonderful in it. What was the process of putting that play together like?
It was exploratory. We didn't know quite what we were going to do, and I thank my lucky stars that Mark Duncan had the patience for us to find the moments in rehearsal, even though the rehearsal time was very short. He did have a vision of how it would go or what we could be, so he always kind of steered us in that direction. But we had to learn a whole new language in a way. All this screenplay dialogue had to be incorporated, so that was the challenge. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So good luck tonight, by the way, on your nomination.
I'm just happy to be here. It's great to be honored. You know, I've seen so many wonderful performances this last year, and it's just stunning that there's so much talent here.
You have another baby that you're birthing here in the South Florida area, yes?
Yeah, I got my Shakespeare Troupe card here. Did you want? I'm the founder of the Shakespeare Troupe. We are now incorporated. We just did a 5-day Shakespeare intensive at the Cushman School in Miami. And we took 40 eighth grade students and trained them on Monday and gave them their scripts and their roles. On Tuesday, we rehearsed them all day, Tuesday and Wednesday and Thursday, and on Friday, we did scenes from As You Like It, from Much Ado About Nothing, Midsummer Night's Dream, and Twelfth Night. To the delight of the entire audience, we had it videographed, and what do you call that word now? It's not photographed anymore, but we had it on camera, and we're going to edit that soon.
So it was a success.
Oh, God, yeah.
Oh, that's awesome. That's awesome.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, I've performed with you in the Shakespeare Troupe.
We have done some Beatrice and Benedict.
Yes, and I'm looking forward to getting back to it.
Thank you. I want you there. Yeah. Yes.
I don't know when that's going to be, but it's soon.
Well, you're busy.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, I'm busy. Yeah.
Okay.
But that's a good thing, right?
To be busy?
Yes.
Oh, that's what we're here for, right? Yeah. Work. I think, was it Chekhov? One of those greats said, if you ain't working, it's just not worth it somehow.
Yeah. Good luck tonight. I'll see you inside. And it's great to see you as usual.
Okay.
Okay.
Good night. Have a great day.
Yes.
Great night.
Okay. Hi. I am here with Rick Pena, costume designer extraordinaire. Hi.
Hi. How are you doing?
I'm great. Rick is a costume designer for Slow Burn Theater, who's nominated tonight for Best Costume Design. How are you feeling?
Good. I'm feeling good.
Yeah. This is the first time I've gotten to interview you. You execute and create costumes like somebody that has, like an octopus.
Well, yeah. I almost have to.
Yeah, which is like crazy. I've never seen anything like it.
Yeah, we just keep going.
How do you do that?
Just a lot of motivation and a lot of teamwork within the design team. Fortunately, I had a couple people helping me with a couple shows this past season, but normally it's just me, but you know, I just keep going.
The show you're nominated for tonight is?
Hunchback of Notre Dame.
Okay. And sometimes you all have three shows going at one time, is that
right? Yes. This past season we actually had Titanic, James and the Giant Peach, and Xanadu happening at the same time.
Yeah, I just want you to know that I'm in the background sitting back going, what the... I just wanted you to know that, you know?
It's a lot of planning, a lot of planning ahead.
Yeah. What's your background in costume design?
Well, I initially first started sewing actually with my grandmother when I was a kid. So I've always been involved with sewing, and I used to have her help me make costumes because she was a seamstress. And then I went to school at FIU. I went for theater, and I spent all my time in the costume shop there, all 4 years. And then when Slow Burn Theater came around, I was actually cast as their lead in their first show. And their next show, I was like, you know, I do costumes, right? And they were like, really? Okay, we're going to put you to work. So the rest is history.
Well, congratulations. I wish you a lot of luck. You're obviously a very talented guy. You're well-deserving. So the very best to you tonight.
Thank you so much. Yeah. I appreciate it.
Yeah, great. I'll see you inside.
Yes, absolutely.
Okay. Hi, I'm sitting here with this beautiful actress, Miss Rita Jo. She is nominated tonight for Best Actress in Island City Stage, The Submission. Hey.
Hi. Thank
Welcome.
You for having me. Thank you.
It's good to have you here.
Well, I'm excited to be here. This is actually my very first Carbonell Awards, so I'm excited to be here.
Awesome. Is it your first time attending?
Yes, it is my first time attending.
And your first nomination?
Yes.
So it's a double whammy for you.
Yes, this is exciting, yes.
Tell us a little bit about the role you're nominated for.
I'm nominated for Best Actress for the role of Emily in The Submission. I did it with the Island City Stage. And Emily is, she's a complex character. There's so many levels to Emily. And I think that was probably the most challenging part. Her progression from the start of the play to the end. Emily is very like strong in her beliefs. She's opinionated, but at the same time, she's soft and she's friendly and approachable until she's pushed to the edge, and then she becomes your worst nightmare.
Okay. So. Okay. Was that a character that was easily accessible for you?
So many levels to her. So some things were easy, and some things I had to really search deep and go there and do some research, yes.
You've worked for other theaters in the South Florida area, right?
Yes, I've also worked with the M Ensemble. I just did Brothers of the Dust with M Ensemble. A few weeks prior to that, I did Terror with the Colony Theater. I work with the APAC Theater as well. So yeah, there's a couple of theaters that I do work with. Mm-hmm. And a couple more I'm looking forward to working with.
Well, it's really great having you here. This being your first Carbonell award night, I just want to say welcome.
Oh, thank you. I'm so excited.
You're going to have a blast.
I know. I'm expecting it. I've heard so much about the Carbonells. Yeah. And it's just walking out on the red carpet and everything, it's so beautiful. So I can only imagine what the ceremony is going to be like.
Yeah. It's just, yeah. You know, the South Florida theater community is a pretty tight-knit little group, so you get to see everybody, you get to see everybody clean up, you know, and get out of their rehearsal clothes and, you know, put on some clean clothes, and so you're going to have a great night. And so I'm wishing you the very best, and is there anything you'd like to say to our viewing audience?
Well, I'm just so thankful for this opportunity, first of all, to be here, and then to be nominated for such a prestigious award. I mean, that's big. And I'm excited, and thank you to Island City Stage for giving me a platform to express myself. So thank you.
Awesome. Awesome. Great. Great luck tonight. Okay.
Thank you. Thank you.
I'm sitting here with this really handsome, debonair playwright named Dan Clancy. Hi, Dan.
Hi, how are you, Karen? You can continue with some more nice adjectives.
Yeah, and that's a great tie.
Thank you. I was just out in Palm Springs, went into the Palm Springs Modern Museum, and I said, this is it.
Oh, yeah.
We don't match the...
That's okay. It doesn't matter. Okay. It's not necessary. So you're nominated tonight for Best New Work, yes?
Correct.
And the name of your play is?
Middletown.
Could you tell us a little bit about Middletown?
Sure. It's a play about two couples from Middletown, New Jersey, who've been friends for 37 years. And I think the theme of the play basically is the only way to have a friend is to be a friend.
Wow. Wow. You see, I was waiting for more and was like, well, there's not much more after that.
That's basically what I was dealing with. I sort of, when I'm writing a play, either it's character-driven or sometimes subject-driven, and this was sort of like a theme-driven play.
Mm-hmm. I was doing a production at the time, so I couldn't see it, but I heard great things about it, and you had some really good actors.
I had absolutely amazing actors, Angie and Barbara and Peter, and a wonderful director, Peter Paletsky. I just lucked out. Myrna Loman read the piece. It was developed at the Jan McCart Reading Series, and Myrna said yes. Mm-hmm. And then the JCC and Suzanne gave it a home, and then Peter brought thought and soul to that home, and then of course the incredible ensemble who inhabited this place so beautifully. So once in a while you really luck out, and I really lucked out this time.
Dan is also the playwright of another timeless South Florida gem that received lots of Carbonells a couple of years ago, The Timekeepers.
Timekeepers it is, yes. I guess about 2 or 3 years ago, first time at the Carbonell, and the play got nominated for 6 Carbonells, and they won all 6. I couldn't be nominated because Timekeepers had other productions in the country and around the world, but yeah. that was a really exciting evening.
Yes, you definitely made your mark on South Florida Theater as a playwright.
Oh, thank you.
Yes, and I've done one of your plays, so I know.
Yes, and she was wonderful. This is one of the most fearless and the most talented actresses in South Florida. And when I worked with her, I said, you just walk on the stage, and as a playwright, you have nothing to worry about. And she sang some beautiful songs, and we had a great time working together.
Thank you, Dan.
It will happen again.
I hope so. That's one of the most beautiful things a playwright can tell an actor, believe me.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. And good luck tonight.
I'm here to have a wonderful time.
I'll see you inside.
Okay.
Here we have Mrs. Judith Mitchell, the CEO of the Kravis Center of the Performing Arts in West Palm Beach, Florida. Welcome, Judith.
Well, thank you so much. I'm delighted to be here tonight.
So tonight, you are here for a special reason. Yes?
I am. I'm very honored to be receiving the Abbott Award, and I'm really excited, quite pleased and humbled by the whole thing.
The George Abbott Award is an award that's given out to a deserving arts person every year in this community. What did you feel, or how did you react when you found out that you've been awarded the Abbott Award?
Well, first of all, I said somebody's made some mistake because I'm aware of some of the previous recipients and just really honored to be in their company.
Mm-hmm. Well, George Abbott was a giant in the American theater, and from what I understand, the people who are nominated for this award are people who've been very effective in the arts arena, and that you have been. I know personally, you being the CEO of the Kravis Center, I was around when the Kravis Center was being constructed. I remember doing children's theater that had to do with the construction of the Kravis Center before it was even built. Then you were in the coordination with Florida State. Is that true?
That's right. We were fortunate to do a number of collaborative projects with Florida State, and we were delighted to have you performing in many of our different venues, in fact, at the Kravis Center.
Yes, it's been a joy, and it's really nice because whenever I see you, it's like seeing an old friend. It's like seeing, you know, someone that I've known for a long time. Someone, it's reassuring to know that you're still there.
Well, thank you. It has been a long time. I was there during the construction. We have just this year, we're celebrating our 25th season of operations. And I've been there the entire time. I've actually been there 27 years. So I've sort of grown up in this, in that particular venue and community.
Is there something that you haven't accomplished in the area of the art, and especially the Kravis Center, that you'd like to?
Well, I think the continued collaboration with other arts organizations is very important to us. I think the advent of us presenting Broadway was something that I had long wanted to do, coming up this next year will be our 10th year of doing that, so I'm very excited and pleased about that. Overall, I think just building the team, building the organization, I'm feeling in a celebratory mood about this 25th season celebration. And then, of course, we turn to look for the next 25, probably not with me, but we're looking at the next 25 as we move forward with the new board members, new board chairs, building the community, and broadening our audience. That's been a very big thing that we really are looking to broaden the demographics and make sure that we have something for everybody, including a younger market, including our full-time year-round residents. So there's a lot of things still on the drawing board.
That's wonderful. Congratulations on the receiving the Abbott Award. Thank you for joining us tonight, and much success for another 25 years at the Kravis Center.
Thank you so much. It's just a pleasure to be here tonight.
Okay, we'll see you tonight.
Thank you.
Bye-bye. Hi, I'm sitting here with Mia Matthews, star of stage and screen. Doesn't she look glamorous? She looks like one of those 40 starlets, doesn't she?
Oh, I was going for that.
Yes, it works. Yeah. Welcome tonight.
Thank you, Karen.
You're nominated tonight?
I am, for a little play that you might have heard of.
After
Karen, my co-star. Yeah.
Congratulations. Congratulations. How are you feeling? I know you make a joke out of being nominated last year and not, you know, getting the award, and you're very self, you know, facing about it, but really, I know you're happy to be here tonight.
I am really, really thrilled. I mean, and there's no expectation once again. And I this is an interesting thing that I try to explain to people that are outside of South Florida, is that Broadway opens how many plays a year? Not that many. South Florida opens how many plays a year? Like hundreds? And to be part of a group of five for this nomination, it really is huge.
Yeah.
It really is huge.
Yeah.
And it's one of those things that any one of us deserve it, and any one of us could win it, so it is enough to be nominated.
Well,
although it would probably feel a lot better to win.
Well,
having been nominated last year and not winning.
Well, as someone who waited a lot of years to finally get one, it does feel good to win.
I bet.
So, but I just want to say that I was in the ensemble of the show that you're nominated for, and you're definitely deserving of the nomination. You gave a really wonderful performance, and I'm so glad I got a chance to work with you, because, I mean, like, you are one of the funniest, most beautiful people that I have met in the Sophomore Theater, really.
You cry. I know. It's such a love fest. It's such a love fest. And of course, I had admired your work from the audience. And when I heard you were doing it, I was like, oh my God, I'm actually going to be on the same stage with her. And to have developed such a friendship makes me very happy. And I, you know, it was funny, I was like reading some things and they were talking about, Stanislavski was talking about collective collaborative art is like the root of what we do, or the effort is the root of what we do. And I said, you know, that show was exactly that. I mean, collaborative, collective effort, like, yes. Across the board. Yes. It was really special, yes. Really special.
Yes. Anything interesting on the horizon?
I have like 4 television and film things coming out all at the same time, even though I shot them far apart. So they're all coming out in the next month. So that's really exciting. But I don't have a job. Out there in TV land, I'm available.
She's available. Well, good luck tonight, Mia.
Thank you. You know, win or lose, it really doesn't matter. I'm so happy to be here. I'm so happy to be here with you.
I'm so happy to be here with you. And good luck. I love you to death.
I love you too. Mwah.
This is Patrick Fitzwater, Artistic Director of Slow Burn Theater. Yes. I'm sorry, I had
There's a lot going on.
There's a lot going on. I've got a lot of people sitting in this chair, but yes, Artistic Director of Slow Burn Theater. Hi, Patrick.
Hi, how are you, Karen?
I'm great. You look fabulous.
Oh, thank you. I just, something spring and fun and some life.
I'm loving it.
I saw the pink and I'm like, that's mine.
Oh yeah, absolutely. I love plaid, I love paisley. It's 2 of my favorite prints. Okay. So two of you and me together, it's magic.
Yes, that's right, we are.
Tell us what you're nominated for tonight.
I personally am nominated for Best Director for Spring Awakening and Choreographer for Heathers. And our company is nominated for Best Musical for Spring Awakening and The Hunchback of Notre Dame.
That is absolutely awesome. I just talked to Rick and I've talked to him about having, you know, being an octopus and doing the multitasking. But you are also not only an octopus, but you got 3 heads on your shoulders at one time because you're directing one show while you're putting one in another space and auditioning it. Talk about that.
Oh, geez, Karen. So, yeah, it's been a wild season. So with the schedule here at the Bardson, we have had one in production over at the main house. Then we would have one upstairs in the New River Room that would tour and go all the way up to Jacksonville. And then this week was Big River season auditions, everything. So I think I was an octopus with a little bit of squid.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. A little squid ink, you know.
How do you do that?
I don't know. I have no idea. Organization. You know, just, you know, I think having a clear vision and a clear picture and just things do, they materialize before you. And
a lot of delegating?
Yeah, as much as I can. I'm learning to be better about it, to be honest with you. The busier we get, the more people that we need to help us as we grow.
So I'm not going to, I mean, it's kind of a trite question, but where do you get the energy? Because, you know, when... your brain gets tired.
It does.
You know? Yeah. I mean, it's hard to be creative when you're tired. How do you overcome that?
I overcome it by honestly going to the beach, just unplugging. It is really hard for me to escape musical theater, though, because I love musical theater. So my escape is actually musical theater at the same time. So even if I'm not working on a show, I'm listening to Hamilton or something that I'm not doing right now. But just all forms of media. I mean, I read. I also like to draw. So it's amazing how you can put one side of your brain on pause, but yet it's still creating as you're feeding another side of your soul.
Yeah.
So that's really how I keep it together. And just, like I said, have a clear vision and so many talented people down here. I mean, the talent is ridiculous.
Yeah. Yeah.
So, I mean, that makes my job a lot easier.
You've had a lot of success. You know, I wish you more success. Is there anything that you haven't done that you're, like, rip-roaring ready to do?
Well, I mean, we've had some great chat, like Hunchback was a good one for us. We've now built this great relationship with Disney. And then just things as with the company working towards becoming a union theater. So those have been our long-term goals, and now we're really starting to see those materialize. So really focusing now on the back end of the house, and as well as focusing what's on front of the house, but taking care of the back of the house, I think, is really where my mindset is now, and growing and stepping everything up one more level.
Yeah, you've done some really big projects. You've done
Yes,
Hunchback, Titanic.
Big River.
Big River.
Aida, tomorrow starts. So, yeah, I mean, they're all huge shows, and that's been a little bit of an interesting challenge playing up against a Broadway house here at the Broward Center, because of the fact is we have to compete with that market. So when you have things like Something Rotten coming through, you know, people only have so much for an entertainment dollar, so you got to let them decide where they're going to spend it. So you got to have that game high.
Yes, yes, and your game is high.
Thank you.
You know that.
Thank you.
Yes, you know. Hey, you are the multiple nominee tonight. Your theater's nominated. I wish you the very best. Good luck.
Thank you so much. Okay. So good to see you.
You too. Sorry, thanks. Mwah. I'm here with Peter Lovello. Hi, Peter.
Hi. How are you?
I'm great. Welcome.
Thank you.
Tell us, what are you nominated for tonight?
Costume designer.
For?
Perfect Arrangement. Sorry, I had to think which one it was.
Perfect Arrangement, and that was at
Island City Stage.
Island City Stage, yes, yes, that's right, because we talked to Christina a little earlier.
Yes, she's a co-nominee, yes.
Yes, yes. How did you get that gig?
Well, I am a board member of Island City Stage, but I've been doing costumes for 50 years now, so it's been a while, and I've been doing it here in South Florida for about 14.
Okay, so you've been doing costumes for Island City Stage all along?
Since the inception, yeah.
Oh, okay, see, I didn't know that. I'm really, you know.
You're pretty, I get it.
Thank you.
You're welcome, anytime.
So, tell us what coming up with a costume design for this particular show entailed.
Well, I was really fortunate because Andy Rogo, our artistic director, was the director, and he allowed me a huge amount of freedom to create what I saw. But you read the script, you meet with the director, you meet with the set designer, see how colors are going to play out, and you go from there. Mm-hmm. So,
do you do any original craft work yourself?
Well, everything that the women wore were mine, mm-hmm. so they were all hand done.
Okay.
But yes, I mean, I've been sewing since I was five.
Yeah.
So,
yeah. I mean, because I know a lot of times now, you know, a lot of costumes are off the rack,
yes.
you know. So how do you feel about that as far as, you know, in the old days when a costume designer would create everything from scratch, and now it's kind of like...
Well, I understand it because it's a budget mm-hmm. situation. Mm-hmm. I'm very fortunate that I know how to sew. So if something is required specifically, I can actually do it at little or no cost for them. I don't usually charge for my labor. Mm-hmm. So it works for me. Mm-hmm. Plus, it's really hard when you're doing a period piece to not only find the garment in the size you need it in, but the color you need it in, and make sure the fabric hasn't rotted or old, that it's gonna fall apart. So you have to create it from scratch. Hopefully though, they allow that in the budget. Hopefully when the people put the budgets together, they realize, oh, we're doing a 1920s, we need all period. Mm-hmm. But it's not always that way. And then the other thing is, as you mentioned, it's hard. I don't know the judging, how they handle it, but I thought there should have been two separate categories because of that, because mm-hmm. you can have all this stuff rented and you did really styling, as opposed to a designer who actually sits down and designs and makes everything. Mm.
That's an interesting point.
Thank you.
Yeah. For the, yeah.
Been thinking about that one for a while.
Yeah. Okay. We'll talk about that. Okay. Yeah. I'm sure some other costumers would probably like to talk about that with you too. Is there? How long have you been in the South Florida area?
14 years now.
Oh. Okay. So did you come down to work specifically for Island City Stage?
No. I came down to be with the man of my life. So.
Okay. Yeah. That's a good incentive to relocate. Okay. And get some work on the side.
Well, it's really, truly a side work because I came from L.A., so I was doing film and theater and TV out there.
Mm-hmm.
And here, there is no real film and TV.
Unfortunately, no.
Yeah, so, yeah. But theater is still, you know, you're most creative in theater. You don't have the money that TV and film has, but you have more creativity.
Yeah, yeah. So. And it's alive and well here in the South Florida area.
I'm enjoying it immensely, yeah, so yes.
Yeah. Well, welcome. We're glad to have you.
Thank you.
I'm sitting here with this beautiful, beautiful doll, Shane Montpremier. I say Montpremier, right? That's why it's really, see, I know. who is nominated tonight for her role in Gable Stage's The Royale. But I know her most recently as playing my daughter at Theater Lab's Motherland, and that's how I got to know her. Isn't she beautiful? Welcome, Shane.
Thank you, Karen. You're too kind.
I know. It's not kind to say you're beautiful, because you really are. So tell me a little bit about the role that you're nominated for.
I play the main character's sister, Nina, who is very protective of her younger brother and basically has a mother-like role towards him.
Did you find out anything about yourself as an actor playing this role?
Oh my goodness. The amount of emotional trauma that I had to go through every night, I think I realized how much I like to repress and how, I guess, inappropriate I've told myself, like, crying is inappropriate. You need to hide it and you need to be strong. But in order to really open up to the character, I had to just completely let go. So, I think I learned that about myself.
Well, you should be very proud of your performance. I took notice of you immediately, not only because, you know, you are beautiful, but you're very talented, you know. And sometimes, you know, when that jumps out from the stage, you know, that means that's the real thing, you know. And your talent really did jump out from the stage. Your commitment to your character. Is this your first Carbonell?
It's my first Carbonell, and that was my first theater show.
You and Ajima, I mean, like, really? Really? I mean, come on. Like,
my bro.
Yeah.
He's standing right there to support me.
I know. So two of you, your first time out, you get a Carbonell nomination, and you're here at the Carbonell Awards for the first time. How's it feel?
I'm still surprised to be here, honestly. I'm like, you guys sure? But yeah, no, it's amazing, really amazing.
Well, you're going to be a hit, you know, either way, win or lose, you're going to be a hit, so, you know.
I'm just excited to be here and happy to be here. I'm grateful to be here.
Yeah, good thing. Good luck tonight.
Thank you.
Okay, I'll see you inside. Mwah! Hi, we're here with Christian Bickich.
We got it.
I feel like I'm saying a bad word.
Lots of foul play in high school. There was a lot of foul play on my last name. I won't say any of the words here, but I got things like bikini.
I can't
go any further than that.
Yeah.
Just, you know.
Okay. You're nominated for an award tonight.
Yes. Yeah. For Best Supporting Actor in Hand to God. I played Timothy. It was a blast from beginning to end. A little crazy as well, because Timothy was a little crazy. And now we're here.
Yeah. That was at Gable Stage?
Yes, at Gable Stage, directed by the wonderful Joe Adler. Who else was in it? Marjorie Lowe. We had Steve Anthony, the man who can't be broken, but was broken. We had Wesley Slade and Casey Sacco.
Yeah. It was a great production. I saw it. What are you most proud about with that role?
Just being able to do it. Yeah. It was surprisingly difficult. I said this in the Carbonell spotlight, but it was like jumping out of an airplane with no parachute. I really didn't know what was going to happen.
Yeah. What was it like making love to Marjorie Lowe?
It was pretty sweet. It was intense. It was real. I mean, it was strong. It was.
Yeah.
You should have been there, all of you people out there.
Yeah. So what do you have coming up next?
Right now, just getting ready for audition season and just getting ready to do auditions and all that fun stuff. Might be taking a brief trip out to L.A., might be moving there. Who knows? We'll see.
Everybody's going to L.A. What is that all about?
I know, right? It's just my best friend's living out there and he loves it, so he wants me to check it out for a couple weeks, and we'll see from there on.
Okay.
But, I'm going to miss South Florida if I do end up going out there. So,
South Florida will miss you.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Karen.
Good luck tonight.
Thank you. It's an honor to be here.
Yeah. Okay. We'll see you inside.
Perfect. Sounds good.
Mwah.
Mwah.
This is my baby, Matthew Carinco. Watch him blush. Hi, Matthew. How you doing?
I'm doing great. And you?
I'm great. It's great to see you.
And you?
I'm loving your outfit.
Thank you very much. My mother dressed me.
Yeah, it's great. She's got great taste.
She does.
What are you nominated for tonight?
I'm nominated for Best Supporting Actor in a Musical for Hunchback of Notre Dame.
That's awesome. And that is for Slow Burn Theater?
Yes.
Of which you are the assistant?
Co-founder and executive director, yes.
So what's it like being wearing the two hats of actor and assistant executive producer and co-founder?
There's a lot more going on in your head than your lines, because if something happens off backstage, you're like, okay, what are we going to do about this? But like, no, I got to be on stage. It's hard to separate the two, and sometimes it's are harder than others. Mm-hmm. But this was a joy. This one, although Hurricane Matthew interrupted our rehearsal process for this one, so I had to wear both hats for a couple of days. But everybody pulled together, and really, it was an amazing show, amazing experience.
I was doing a show at the time, so I didn't get to see it. I was very disappointed because you know how I love to hear you sing.
I know you do, and I would have loved to seen you there. But we all miss more than we want to. But it's the other edge of being a working actor. Yeah. Is you're doing stuff, so you miss stuff. Yeah. But
so how much of a hand do you have in putting the shows together if you're also performing?
Well, it depends on the show. This one was the first show of our season, so we had the summer beforehand. So I had a lot to do. We sewed all the robes, so I was the cutter. I didn't sew anything, but I had the pattern, and I cut out 28, 30 some odd robes for the whole thing. And when you have that much time, it's a little easier to get that stuff off. Yes. And then it's a little less on your head once you do start rehearsal process. Yes. And in only 2.5 weeks that we put one of those shows together.
Yeah.
So once the rehearsal process starts, I'm not available for much other than what I'm doing.
Yeah. What's next?
Well, Aida is next for Slow Burn Theater. I'm not in that, but like I said, then I'll be much more involved behind the scenes. And then we're casting our next season in the next couple of weeks. So that's what's next.
Awesome. Awesome. Good luck tonight.
Thank you so much. Always good to see you.
Yes, it's good to see you. You know I love you.
I love you too.
Okay, good luck.
All right, see ya.
Okay.
Be good.
Yes.
All right.
I'm sitting here with the fantabulous Connor Walton. You look magnificent.
Thank you. I mean, this old thing.
This is all you.
This is all me. Yeah.
You put it all together.
I put it all together.
Yeah, it's you.
I came straight from the gym.
You doing it, babe?
Thank you.
Tell us what you're nominated for tonight.
I am nominated for Best Supporting Actor in a Play for the Normal Heart.
And that was at
Outre Theater Company.
Okay. Was that your first time? That wasn't your first time working with Outre.
It was not my first time working with Outre, but it was my first time doing a play with Outre.
What was that experience like?
Different. It's been so long since I've done a play, so it was refreshing and new. It was an adventure, something exciting that I never get to do because I'm always in musicals. Yeah. So it was fun.
And was it out of the norm for your typical performance style?
Yes, because it was a very serious play, and I'm usually cast as the funny sidekick most of the time in musicals. Yeah. So, yeah, it was very, very out of the norm for me, which was nice.
Yeah. So what was that process like for you?
Exhausting and draining. I did a show with Outre called Thrill Me that was a musical, and it was dark, and I played a child killer. And my husband told me he preferred it when I played child killers because I came home in a better mood.
Really?
I would be so drained after the show. It was such an exhausting experience and a roller coaster of a ride to go through because of what that character had to suffer and because it is based on reality, it was very difficult and emotionally draining.
Yeah. I'm really sorry that I missed that one because I would love to see you do that kind of work. You have an intensity about you that is kind of riveting, and I bet that that's what, you know, got you this nomination.
I hope so. Fingers crossed.
Yeah. Well, good luck tonight.
Thank you.
Yeah, it's much deserved.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Is there anything you'd like to say to the South Florida theater community before you go?
Wear more sequins. We could use more sequins here.
You heard it from the man himself. Wear more sequins. Get a full shot. We'll see you inside, Mark. Mwah. It's going to look like I have a preference for men, but that's not, well, it's the case, but it's not really, but that seems to be like most of who I'm interviewing right now, and like really, really handsome men, this one, you know, there are a lot of handsome South Florida actors, I have to say. But hi, Alex.
Hi, Karen. How are you?
How are you?
Good to see you.
It's good to see you, yeah. Too. You're nominated.
I am.
Yes. Yeah.
For Best Supporting Actor in a Play.
For Thinking Cat?
No.
No.
For Gable Stage.
For Gable Stage.
That's
oh,
right.
Sorry.
That's right. Stalking the Boogeyman. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. I thought I saw your name for something else.
It was not. Oh, Best Ensemble.
Oh, okay.
Best Ensemble is Thinking Cat for Mudd.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, all right. Okay.
Gretchen and okay. Kristen Van de Pass.
Okay. So you were nominated for being the bad guy.
Yeah. Really, really bad. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Really, really bad.
Mm-hmm. That was... Well, I've seen you play a bad guy before, so it wasn't a stretch for you so much.
No, but you know what's interesting is it wasn't so much a stretch, but it felt like I had to kind of bring more of a humanity to him. Like, I couldn't just make him totally, like, terrible, even though people would probably think he's totally terrible, you know?
Well, because no one really is totally terrible, right?
Right. Well, I mean,
there's humanity somewhere.
Right. One would hope. One would hope. Yeah.
Well, I saw it. You were great. You were, you know, as you usually are. What's next?
I am doing a play at Island City Stage called The Goldberg Variations, written by Mr. Stuart Meltzer. Yeah. I play Pablo, the boyfriend of the main character. Mm-hmm. Yeah, played by Mike Westridge.
When does that go up?
This summer. I believe it's in June or July, but don't quote me on that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. One show that you did last season is in New York right now, right?
It is, yeah. I did the world premiere of Daniel's Husband. That was one of the best experiences I've ever had. Yeah.
Written by Michael McKeever.
Written by Mr. Michael McKeever. Yeah.
And it won Best New Work?
It won Best New Work last year. I think it also won Best Play, production of a play. Yeah.
So you're rocking and rolling.
Am I?
You've been busy this year.
I have been busy. Yeah. I've been busy for the last couple years. It's been a lucky couple years.
Well, that's good, because it's always great to see you on stage. Have a good night tonight. Good luck.
Thank you.
Okay. Mwah. I'm here with my after cast mate, Jenny Hacker, who is nominated tonight for Best Supporting Actress.
I am in for After.
Yay.
And Best Actress in a Musical for Passion.
Yes. So she's a double nominee tonight. Yes.
Double the fun.
Double the fun.
Double the stress.
Double the chance of winning.
Double the chance, exactly. I like that.
Yeah.
That like bumps me up to 50%, right?
Yeah.
Or something like that? Yeah.
That's not a bad place to be in.
I'm okay with that. I'm okay with that.
Well, you know, you nominated for two roles that you did an awesome job in. How does it feel?
It feels really strange because I haven't been nominated before. So this whole experience to come to the Carbonells as a nominee is very different. I feel like I'm a top that's wound up, but I'm, but no one's letting the string go, so I just feel like this. It's a very different experience. It's not as relaxed as usual. You're just seeing all your friends. For some reason, there's a little bit of hype going on. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it's hard not to. You know, we're only human. You know, even as much as we say, okay, I'm not gonna let it get to me. I'm not gonna, you know, get my hopes up and all this stuff. It's hard not to.
Absolutely.
Get
the hopes go up on their own. They don't need you to send them there. The hopes are up. Yeah.
So what was different about the two shows that you nominated?
Oh gosh. Well, I think Passion was a stretch musically. It was a stretch character wise because she was such an odd person. She was so sick. She was so frail. She was so obsessive and contrary to what most may think. That's actually not inherent to my personality. And then in After, I think I was very similar to my character in After. I think Michael wrote a mother that I could relate to. I don't think I'm quite as much of a helicopter mom as she is. My children might say different, but I think I felt I felt like those were my words coming out of my mouth. Any of them really could have been. So,
Well, good luck tonight.
Thank you.
It's much deserved, and I will see you inside.
Thank you.
Okay.
Love you.
Mwah.
Bye.
Love you. I'm here with the beautiful Elizabeth Price, one of the better-known actresses in our South Florida theater community. She's new to our South Florida theater community, but boy, has she come in like a little hurricane from Texas. Hi, Elizabeth.
Hi there. How you doing?
I'm good. How are you?
Good.
You're nominated tonight for?
Best Actress in a Play for Reborning.
At the Arts Garage.
You got
I'm
it.
Sorry. Yes. Tell us what doing that role was like.
Well, you know, it's great to be nominated for a role where you play a crazy person with drug and alcohol problems and identity issues, and you get nominated for that. You know, you play to your strengths.
Yeah. It's a big well to dip from, though. Right?
It is. But you know, I found it somehow.
Yeah. I love playing those roles, you know? Yeah, because, it's like wading in an ocean, and, you get to pick up fish and squid and octopus and just carry them right along with you.
Yeah, there was a lot of calamari. No, but it was great. It was a great role. It was a great play, and I love a descent into madness, you know, where a character doesn't even know she's doing that. It's great because you're convinced the whole way that what you're doing is perfectly rational and reasonable, but from the outside, not so much.
Yeah. This isn't your first Carbonell.
I went years ago when I'd first arrived to Miami just to support some friends, but this is my first one here as a real person.
As a nominee, congratulations. Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, well, good luck tonight. Is there anything you'd like to say to the South Florida theater community before hopping off into the ballroom?
I love you a whole lot. How about that?
Right. Good luck tonight. We'll see you inside.
Okay.
I'm sitting here with Chris Crawford. Hi, Chris.
Hi, Karen.
Welcome.
Thank you. It's good to be here.
It's good to see you.
Yeah, it's nice to be back.
Yeah, you're nominated tonight for?
Best Actor in a Play for Buyer and Seller at Actors Playhouse.
That was a really big deal for you. Got rave reviews. How was it to do that show?
Oh, it was an amazing experience. I mean, I think it's an actor's dream to do a one-person show, but to do a show like that just is so community with the audience was such a dream come true for me. And, you know, I mean, being on stage by yourself for 70 minutes is quite an undertaking.
Yeah.
So, but it was fun. I ate characters, and David Risco was just a brilliant director to work with, too. So,
So there's a whole, doing a one-person show is a whole different, animal, you know. Can you just give the audience, before we wrap this up, just a tidbit of what it takes to do that?
Oh, I think more than anything, it takes a lot of patience, and it takes you getting off your own back. You know, when you are all that's in the rehearsal room, the tendency is to be really difficult on yourself and to be really upset if you don't get it right, right away. But doing a one-person show just proves that what we do is all about process. Mm-hmm. So that was the tricky thing for me was, Chris, just calm down. It's going to get there.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah. And once you get there, you just fly.
Oh, my gosh. It was an amazing run. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, good luck
tonight. Oh, thank you, Karen.
It's
good to see you.
I'll see you inside.
All right. Okay. Sounds good.
I'm here with this dapper gentleman, Mr. Doug Wetzel, who's a director. You look marvelous.
Well, thank you. Thank you so much. You look beautiful.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
You're nominated tonight, yes?
I am not nominated, but Connor Walton is, and I was the director of The Normal Heart, and he is nominated for Best Supporting Actor.
Okay. Well, you should be nominated.
Yes.
And you should be nominated for that tie.
Oh, my gosh. Thank you so much.
I love it. I love it. What can you tell us about the process of directing Connor in A Normal Heart?
Oh, Connor made it very easy, right from the audition to through. He was actually on vacation the first week of rehearsals, and he flew back from Alaska 3 days early just so he could be part of the rehearsal process from the very beginning. He did his homework. He took direct. He's amazing taking direction. And what amazed me the most about Connor was that this was his first straight play since he graduated with his BFA X number of years ago. He's always done musical theater or comedy, and he just knocked it out of the park. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, you know, they say comedy actors make the best dramatic actors.
Yeah, yeah. Right? He really was the character. Yeah. He really did his homework. Yeah. He was great.
Well, thank you for coming and speaking to us.
Oh, well, thank you.
We're wishing Connor the best and wishing you the best.
Thank you. And I'm the managing director for Outre Theater now, mm-hmm. and our new home is going to be the Pompano Beach Cultural Center, which will open in May. So.
Awesome. And you just had auditions.
And we're having auditions at the end of April, beginning of May.
Okay.
So,
all right.
Yeah.
So that's great. And those auditions will be held?
They're going to be held
at the center?
The callbacks will be held at the center.
Okay.
So,
right.
yes.
Okay.
So
well,
it'll be a wonderful event.
Congratulations.
Thank
to you.
Thank you so much.
Okay. I'm sitting here with my mama. No, I'm just kidding. My love is Iris Acker, who is the producer of Spotlight on the Arts, but she's also worn so many hats in the South Florida theater community over the years. She's been a Carbonell voter. She's an actress, of course, but she's been a Carbonell voter. She's been on the Carbonell committee. She has...
I've been with the Carbonell since the beginning.
Yeah, she's been with the Carbonell since the beginning. She's had her own show on stage with Iris Acker.
Iris Acker, yes.
What am I forgetting?
Nothing, really. You're doing great.
Oh, yeah, she's been a theater producer.
I don't get to be a guest very often, so I'm used to asking the questions. I could take the microphone and say, Karen, while we're here, I'd say... you're usually a winner. You are. I mean, year after year after year, I can say to you, what are you working on now?
Right now, I am about to go over to the West Coast, to Florida Studio Theater, to do a 3-week stage reading of the play Exonerated. And then after that, I'll be doing summer shorts.
How about that? It's summer already.
It's summer already.
Every year you do.
Well, I have for the. This will be the third year in a row. Yeah, that I've done it, and I guess it's a good thing. They keep asking me back, so I must be doing something right, right?
Can you name all your nominations and your wins?
Oh, wow! I can't.
Let's start with those you won for.
Oh well, I only won once, and
that's enough. Me too.
That was for Zoetic Stages, Fear Up Harsh. That was written by Chris Demos Brown. But I've had multiple nominations over the years, and I find that was finally the lucky charm.
What was the lucky charm?
Fear Up Harsh was the lucky charm. Yes.
Oh, without a doubt.
Yeah.
I mean, well, you're saying because you won that time, and rightly so. I mean, you know, what do they say? It's just an honor to be nominated. And it is.
It is.
And it is. I mean,
but winning sure is nice.
Yes, but you're not entertaining tonight. You're not part of the singers at the top of the show.
No, I'm not part of the singers. I am presenting tonight, but I'm not at the top of the show, no.
Okay.
I'm doing your job tonight, Iris.
Are you? I love it. I love it. I love.
I'm having a blast.
I love when the tables are turned.
Yes.
I really do. And our director, Mark,
is
right there
putting
us on.
Yes.
Well, for me, I've been a Carbonell judge for many, many years. And as I say, I started before it was called Carbonell's. It was the South Florida Entertainment Writers Association. And how I got in that, I don't really remember. And this is luxury performing here, you know. Usually, where were we? We were, the Diplomat Hotel. That was the old Diplomat we were. We were at Brian Smith's Theater.
Mm-hmm.
We were at Parker Playhouse.
Mm-hmm.
This performing here at the Amateur Hall Theater is really where it should be. Luxury theater and on stage.
Yeah.
And it should have lovely presenters like yourself.
Thank you, my darling. So you're feeling better now?
Was I not feeling well?
Well, I know you had a little bout there that you were a little under the weather. So you bounce back now?
That little bout was pneumonia.
Okay.
Yes, yeah. And I want to advise everyone, if you have a cold, don't do what I did. Don't ignore it and do everything you ordinarily would do. Accept it, because what happens is it turns into pneumonia.
Yeah.
But here I am. I'm okay. Fine. Okay. I'm just fine. Thanks for asking.
Absolutely. Absolutely. We love you, Iris. Okay. We'll see you inside. Okay? We're bookending with two really extraordinary actresses today. We're ending with Miss Laureline Snedeker, who is a veteran South Florida musical theater actress and actress, as well as regional. Hi.
Hi. I've been here since 1982, off and on.
Yes, that's a long time.
That is a long time. Yes. It is a long time.
And I've been here right along with you.
Yes, you have.
I have.
Yes, you have.
Shh.
I say, underline that veteran.
Veteran.
You know, it's been a phenomenal community. We started out with a couple of dinner theaters and one or two sort of legitimate things that were beginning in the 70s. And this prom of a sold-out house is, you know, the end result. It's pretty spectacular.
Yeah. It's great to see you. It always is.
Thank you.
And whenever you come back to town to do a show, you always bring the house down. You always get rave reviews.
I'm old. My job is, when I teach, is to tell every child that if they do a show, they should learn something each time. Mm-hmm. And as old as I am, I should have learned a lot of things. So hopefully.
Still learning, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah, absolutely. So you're nominated tonight for?
It's only a play, a Gable Stage Best Supporting Actress.
I saw it. You were wonderful.
You
always are.
No.
Yes, you are.
We kind of go a scan sat, but thank you.
Well, even the ones we like kind of go, oh, God, I can't even wait until this show is over, you know, still.
It's lovely. I enjoy working down here. I love the arts community. And this was, you know, I've always been nominated for musicals because I honk. So it's a pleasure to be nominated for a play. It's delicious.
Yeah.
I'm
good.
Happy about it.
Yeah, good for you. Well, you were wonderful, and I really enjoyed your performance in it. I enjoy you every time I see you perform. So what's next for you?
At the moment, I'm doing Midlife, the Crisis Musical for the third time at the Winter Park Playhouse, and then I'm going to go clean my houses and visit my grandchildren because I haven't been there for 4 months. And I've got a concert that I'm doing, and then we'll see what happens after that.
Okay. Yeah. Well, we look forward to seeing you when you get back.
Thank you.
Yeah. Good luck tonight.
Thank you, honey.
Okay.